Well, good evening, everyone. Well, it's time to begin our service for this evening, and I want to welcome you once again in the house of the Lord. Yes, we indeed had a wonderful day yesterday as we commune with our Lord and Savior. And this evening we continue our worship as we praise our God for who He is. And so those of you who are joining us online, or you have been waiting on us, we want to recognize and thank you for clicking on the Talpra SDA Church link. And we pray by God's grace as you worship with us this evening that your hearts will be blessed indeed. So I invite you, let's stand to our feet, those of us who are in-house, and if you are online, we say let's get in the posture of reverence as we come before the throne of grace. Let's bow our heads, let's pray. Father, once again, we are grateful and thankful, first of all, to be in the land of the living, being in a strong frame of mind and in good health. Lord, we say thank you. Even though, gracious God, that we may have had a difficult day or what our experience may be, especially maybe those who are joining us online, we pray that we'll visit them, that you'll bring the necessary peace and comfort to their heart that is necessary so that they can know that indeed you still are in control and concern of every activity or everything that may take place in their lives, gracious God. So be with us, watch over us, and keep us as you prepare our hearts and our minds to receive a word from you, from the one who you have chosen this evening to proclaim your message of salvation. Thank you now for what you do in and through this evening's service, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. It's song number 109. Song number 109, Marvelous Grace of Our Loving Lord, Grace That Exceeds All Sin and All Guilt.
Marvelous grace of our loving Lord, grace that exceeds all sin and all guilt. Yonder on Calvary's Mount outpoured, there where the blood of the Lamb was spilled, and grace, grace, God's grace, grace that will pardon and cleanse within, oh yes, grace, grace, God's grace. Grace that is greater than all of sin, and sin and despair like the sea wave cold, threaten the soul with infinite law. Grace that is greater, yes, grace untold, points to the refuge of my the cross, oh yes, grace, grace, God's grace, a grace that will pardon and cleanse within, grace, grace, God's grace, a grace that is greater than all our sin. And marvelous infinite matchless grace freely bestowed on all who believe. In you that along in the sea of faith, will you this moment this grace receive? And grace, grace, God, grace, grace that will pardon and cleanse within. Grace, grace, God's grace, grace that is greater than all sin.
More about Jesus I would know, more of his grace to others show. Song number 245. Song number 245.
More about Jesus I die for me. More, more about Jesus. More, more about Jesus. More of His saving policy. More of His love who died for me. And more about Jesus, let me learn more of His holy will. Listen, Spirit of God, my teacher be, showing the things of Christ to me. Tell me more, more about Jesus. Tell me more, more about Jesus. More of His saving policy, and more of His love who died for me. And more about Jesus in His word, holding communion with my Lord, hearing His voice in every line, making it be perceived in mind. Tell me more, more about Jesus. Tell me more, more about Jesus. More of His saving food, and more of His love who died for me. And more about Jesus on His throne, richness in glory of His own. More of His kingdom sure increase, more of His coming praise of peace. Tell me more, more about, tell me more, more about, more of His saving fullness, more of His love who died for me.
I am thine, O Lord. I have heard thy voice. Draw me nearer.
I am thine, O Lord. I have heard thy voice, and it told thy love to me. But I long to rise in the arms of it, and be closer drawn to thee. And draw me near, oh yes, now nearer, blessed Lord, to the cross where thou wast died. And draw me nearer, blessed Lord, to thy precious bleeding side. And consecrate me now to thy service, Lord, by the power of grace divine. May my soul look up with a steadfast hope, and my will in thine. And draw me near, oh yes, now nearer, blessed Lord, to the cross where thou wast died. Oh, draw me near, oh yes, now nearer, blessed Lord, and to thy precious bleeding side. And hold the pure delight of that single hour that before thy throne I spend. And when I kneel in prayer and with thee, my God, I commune as friend with friend. Oh, draw me near. Oh, yes, thou nearer, blessed Lord, to the cross where thou hast died. Oh, draw me nearer, blessed Lord, to thy precious bleeding side.
Well, without any further ado for this evening, I want to present to you God's mouthpiece for this time, and it's no one else than our dear elder John Samuel. I ask of you, those of you who are online and those of you who are in house, let us give him our undivided attention as he brings forth God's word this evening.
All right, good evening, everybody. All right, we're here on this beautiful Sunday evening where we can come together as God people. Anyone just share a portion of his holy word with us tonight. Just want to welcome those that are online listening to us. We want to welcome you in a very special way. I trust that we all had a good day today. Yeah, my day was good. I enjoy my day. I spent, a good few hours today in the Word of God, because I had was prepare for a Bible class and then prepare for tonight. So my day was well spent. So I trust you all had a good day also. All right, so welcome to church tonight. Let's bow our head. Father, we give you thanks, Lord, and praise and glorify you for the God you are. I want to thank you for the way how you have been working in our life, the way how you have kept us, Lord, today. You was kind, you was compassionate, you was loving, you was faithful, you was long-suffering towards us today, Lord. And oh, Lord, we just want to say you was great today. And Lord, we just want to thank you for you being our God and being our Father. And as we open your word tonight, Lord, we pray that you will open our hearts that we can receive your word. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. All right. I start off this Revelation chapter 6. With the white horse and the red horse, I share that with us. I mentioned from you from the Word of God, where the writer of John the Revelator of Revelation tell us when he said in the King James Version in Revelation chapter 6, verse 1 and 2, he said, "And I saw when the Lamb opened one of the seals, and I heard as it were the noise of thunder. And one of the four beasts say, Come and see. And I saw and behold a white horse, and he that sat on him had a bow, and a crown was given unto him, and he went forth conquering and conquer." I tell you that, what white symbolize, especially in the book of Revelation. In Revelation, it tells us, white always and without any expectation refer to Christ or his followers and is never used with reference to force of evil. Remember, I shared that with you. Yeah, so white, that was right. Remember in Revelation 1:14, I say that the exalted Christ is portrayed in the book of Revelation as having a white hair, white as wool. I also mentioned to you that the faithful will receive a white stone with a new name written in it, Revelation 2:17. I also mentioned to you, and they are to wear white garment, Revelation chapter 3, verse 4 and 5. 24 elders are clad in white. Remember mentioning all these things with you when we meet, when we talk about this first seal, right? Remember, let me just skip out something here because I want to just, you know, don't want to keep you wearing, you know, as the white says, you know, that we must not weary the saints. Let's take off this fan here a little bit. Right, and then I remember telling you, mentioning to you that, you know, the red horse referred to blood and oppression. You know, this, I tell you that the symbol of the second horseman or the second seal portrayed condition under which the church found itself about the year AD 313. The violent persecution the church suffered at the hands of the Roman Caesars. Right? The church experience represents a hard time Christianity experience in the second and third century. I mentioned to you that Diocletian, an emperor in Rome, what he did to Christians and so on, you know, how we tarred them and put them to death, some were free to hungry lions and so on. So this red horse represent, you know, blood and oppression, right? Today I'm here to help us to understand a little more about what the book of, in Revelation tell us now. In Revelation chapter 5 and verse 6, it said here, "And when he had opened the third seal, I heard a third beast say, 'Come and see.' And I beheld, and lo, a black horse, and he that sat on him had a pair of balance in his hand. And I heard a voice in the midst of the four beasts say, 'A measure of wheat for a penny, and 3 measures of barley for a penny. And see thou hurt not the oil and the wine.'" This is what the black horse represent. If you look, if you read through the verses, or you just sink a little deep in the verse, you will see that this verse, I mean, talking more, referring to a famine. Black is primarily associated with negative aspect of human experience, including death, disease, famine, and sorrow. Soothsaying, witchcraft, fortune teller, sorcery. This is what black represent. These practices are known as black magic. In the Bible, darkness symbolizes the absence of the gospel. And that's why Psalm tells us here, "Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path." So in the Bible, darkness symbolizes the absence of the gospel. "And he that sat on the black horse had a pair of balance in his hand." You know, balance is a device. Balance is really a scale, you know. That's what balance is, you know. Balance is a device to measure weight, right? A balance in the Old Testament functioned as a symbol of famine, to eat bread by weight. Hear what Leviticus chapter 26 verse 26 said, "And when I have broken the staff of your bread, 10 women shall bake your bread in one oven, and they shall deliver you your bread again by weight, and he shall eat and not be satisfied." So the blackness here, according to what the verse saying here in Revelation chapter 6, when it said here now, and when I had opened the third seal, I heard the beast say, come and see. And I beheld a black horse, and he that sat on him had a pair of balance in his hand. What does ten women mean? According to what this verse tells us here, what we now look at in Leviticus chapter 26:26. You see, when I have broken the staff of your bread, 10 women shall bake bread in one oven. 10 women shall bake bread in one oven. What that mean? A famine will be so intense that bread will be so scarce that only one oven will be needed where 10 had been used before. That what this verse is saying, 10 women shall bake in one oven. So the famine is so scarce, folks, that only one oven is needed. And that's why Ezekiel chapter 4 and verse 16 said, moreover, he said unto me, son of man, behold, I will break the staff of bread in Jerusalem, and they shall eat bread by weight and with care, and they shall drink water by measure and with astonishment. The balance point to a time of shortage of food. Let me just read over this. The balance that the Bible said that this black horse, the rider on this black horse had a balance in his hand. The balance point to a time of shortage of food when the basic commodities of life are measured out at great inflated price. The scene of the opening of the third seal portray a famine. It portray a famine condition. Revelation chapter 6 and verse 6, hear what it said. And I heard a voice in the midst of the four beasts say, a measure of wheat for a penny and 3 measures of barley for a penny. And see, thou hurt not the oil nor the wine. The Roman penny represents a wages of an ordinary laborer. In Matthew chapter 20 and verse 2, hear what it said. And when he agreed with the laborers for a penny a day, he sent them into the vineyard. So that was the price that a laborer will work for a day, a penny a day, because the Bible said that, and when he agreed with the laborers for a penny a day, he sent them into his vineyard. A measure of wheat was a daily ration for one person. Barley was a cheap grade of food, and while one could get more for the money, it was not sustaining as wheat. Hence, the day's ration of wheat for a day's laborer represent barley sufficient food for the laborer and his family. Barley, this grain was cheaper than wheat. Barley was a common food of the poor and was used as feed for animals. The rider on the black horse must represent symbolically a spiritual famine of the word of God rather than a physical shortage of food. And that's why the prophet Amos tell us here that suggests that a famine can be spiritual. Amos chapter 8, verse 11 to 13. Hear what it said. Behold, this comes, said the Lord God, that I will send a famine in the land, not a famine for bread or thirst for water, but for hearing the word of the Lord. And they shall wander from sea to sea, and from the north even to the east, and they shall run to and fro, and to seek the word of the Lord, and shall not find it. In that day shall the fair virgin and young men faint for thirst. If the black horse of the third seal is opposite to the white, remember I tell you that the white represent the gospel message that went out in its purity, in its pure form. Remember I tell you that before. So if the black horse of this third seal is opposite to the white horse of the first seal, which the proclamation and the spreading of the gospel, then the opening of this third seal portray a spiritual famine. Grain symbolize the word of God. Luke chapter 8, verse 5 to 15. Hear what I'm saying. Remember telling you that grain represent or symbolize the word of God. Luke chapter 8, verse 5 to 15. Hear what I said. It say a sower went out to sow his seed, and he sowed some. And he sowed. Some fell by the wayside, and it was trodden down, and the fowls of the air devoured it. Some fell upon a rock, and as soon as it was sprung up, it withered away because it lacked moisture. And some fell on thorns, and the thorns sprang up with it and choked it. And other fell on good ground and sprang up and bare fruit 100-fold. And when he had said these things, he cried, "He that had an ear, let him hear." And the disciples asked him, saying, What might be this parable be? And he said unto you, it is given, and he said, unto you it is given to know the mysteries of the kingdom of God. And that's why I say sometimes when we're reading the word of God, we have to sink deep into the word of God. Not just take it and skim it on the surface. We have to sink deep. So that's why he said, and he said, unto you it is given to know the mysteries of the kingdom of God. Unto who? Unto his disciples. You are his disciples today, folks. God is talking to you also, that he's given you the understanding of the mystery of the kingdom of God. So it goes on to say, and he said unto you it is given to know the mysteries of the kingdom of God, but to others in parable, that seeing they might not see, and hearing that they might not understand. Now the parable is this: the seed is the word of God. Those by the wayside are they that hear. Then come the devil and take away the word out of the heart, lest they shall believe and be saved. Then on the rock are they which, when they hear, receive the word with joy, and these have no root, which for a while believe, and in time of temptation fall away. And that which fell among thorns are they which, when they have heard, go forth and are choked with the cares and riches and pleasures of this life, and bring no fruit to perfection. But that on the good ground are they which, in an honest and good heart, having heard a word, keep it and bring forth fruit with patience. The word of God is also the bread of life. Matthew also tells us that in Matthew chapter 4:4, it said, "But he answered and said, it is written, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeded out of the mouth of God." It is a symbol. The bread also represents a symbol of Jesus himself. Jesus said unto them, "Verily, verily, I said unto you, Moses gave you not the bread from heaven, but my Father gave you the true bread from heaven. For the bread of God is he which come down from heaven." Then they say unto him, "Lord, evermore, give us this bread." And Jesus said unto them, "I am the bread of life. He that come to me shall never hunger, and he that believe on me shall never thirst." The scene of opening the third seal has to do with the shortage of God's word or the gospel. The third seal, that's what it represents as a shortage of God's word. You know, in the Middle Ages, it had an emperor they call Diocletian. It had some others too around what was very dread. But this emperor too was a dread king, a dread emperor. He wasn't easy. They said during Diocletian persecution, Bibles were targeted as part of a large program intending to wipe out Christianity. Remember, I tell you, and I wanted to remember what we're looking at here. When the Bible says, and when he had opened the third seal, I heard the third beast say, come and see, and behold, a black horse, and he that sat on him had a pair of balance in his hand. And he heard a voice in the midst of the four beasts saying, a measure of wheat for a penny, and 3 measures of barley for a penny, and see thou hold not the oil. So remember, we're talking about a famine here, where the word is concerned. So during the Diocletian time, the persecution, Bibles were targeted as part of a large program intending to wipe out Christianity. On February 24, 303, Diocletian's first edict against Christians was published. The edict prohibited Christians from assembling for worship and order the destruction of the scriptures, books that are spiritual books, and place of worship across the empire. This is what Diocletian did, right? The destruction of the scripture, spiritual books, your place of worship across the empire, you get rid of those things. Among other persecution against Christians, Diocletian ordered that the destruction of the scripture and anything related to public religious service or ritual across the empire, all that was banned. In AD 301 to 304, the Roman Empire Diocletian burned thousands of copies of the Bible, command that the Bibles be destroyed, and a decree that any home with a Bible in it should be burned. This is the decree that Diocletian passed. In 1198, Pope Innocent III, writing a letter to the Bishop of Mentz, a city in France, banned the reading of Bible in private meeting, which he labeled as occult or hidden assembly. I give you this at 1198. This is what Pope Innocent III did. He wrote a letter to the Bishop of Mentz in a city in France, banning the reading of Bible in private meeting. So it probably in public, it completely banned. But in private now, it banned completely. So no reading of the Bible. And you have those folks who reading the Bible or whatever at a occult, right? But in 1536, it had a guy by the name of William Tyndale. I know we heard about him. He was one of the reformer. When William Tyndale was burned at the stake for translating the Bible into English. According to Tyndale, the church forbid owing or reading the Bible. Why? To control and restrict the teaching and to enhance their own power and importance. It had a next council in Rome, they call it the ruling council of Tarragon. Now, Tarragon was a council of the Roman Catholic Church, which held in the city of Tarragon. That's why they call it the ruling of the council of Tarragon. Right, so Tarragon was a council of the Roman Catholic Church, which held in the city of Tarragon in Catalonia, Spain, by Archbishop John of Tarragona. Hear what he did here. He said, no one may possess the book of the Old and New Testament. Remember, we're talking about a famine. There will be a famine by weight and by measure and so on. So this is what this council introduced here. It said, no one may possess the book of the Old and New Testament in the Roman language. And if anyone possess them, he must turn them over to the local bishop within 8 days of the announcement of this law. Right? In order for Satan to maintain his sway over men and establish the authority of the papal usurper, he must keep them in ignorance of the scripture. For hundreds of years, the circulation of the Bible was prohibited. The people were forbidden to read it or to have it in their house. So what happened? Because all Bibles are banned, all Bibles are burned. You can't read, you can't think. So what happened? Well, the word of God destroyed? It had a group. Under all these persecution and trials that was taking place during that Diocletian time, right? And all during those councils, it had a group they called the Waldenses. I never pronounced that name right. The Waldenses. Thank you, Sister Philip. Yeah, this group, Waldenses. Keep it in mind. Satan had urged on the papal priests and other high-ranking members of the clergy to bury the word of truth beneath the rubbish of error, heresy, and suspicion. That was Satan's aim, using men, using these emperors, using priests, using high-ranking officials, right? But in the most wonderful manner, it was preserved, uncorrupt, through all the ages of darkness. But like the ark upon the billows deep, the word of God outride the storm that threatened it with destruction. Ellen White said that in Great Comedy, page 64. Remember these Waldenses, right? Remember the Bible tells us here. Let me just read it here so we could have an understanding how they come about also. So if you look at Revelation chapter 12 and verse 1 and 2, hear what it said. And there appeared a great wonder in heaven. A woman clothed with the sun and the moon under her feet, and upon her head a crown of 12 stars. And she, being with child, cried, traveling in birth and pain to be delivered. Revelation 12:6. And the woman fled into the wilderness. So this woman here, it really representing the church, you know. This woman here representing the Waldenses who keep the word of life, who keep the word alive. So nothing was missing or taken away, because these folks, even under all the destruction that was taking place, the burning of Bibles and all kinds of things, somewhere I read, I don't know if I have it in the script here, but somewhere I read, I said there, some of them even memorize the word, so the word couldn't have destroyed, right? So that's what Revelation tells us. And the woman fled in the wilderness, where she had a place prepared of God, that they should be fed here the 1,260 days. These folks represent the Waldenses who fled into the wilderness when this persecution was taking place. Let me just read something here for you. And this reading, I want to give it some credit, right? I just get a few things, and I just want to highlight just a few things I want to share from it. But I want to give it credit from where it come from. This come from Ted Wilson. Concerning the, well, we all know who Ted Wilson is? Huh? Right, that's the president of the General Conference, right? The highest officer of our church. Hear what I said, you know, concerning the wilderness. It said in the early centuries of the Dark Ages, as papal power sought to bring the entire world under its control, groups of faithful believers were still letting their light shine as they stayed true to the Bible truth. Of this group, the Waldenese were perhaps the most well-known. They served during a time of great darkness as a faithful link between the ancient apostolic faith and the Reformation that came centuries later. It goes on to say, the Waldenese live in the valley and mountains of the Piedmont Alps, a beautiful area of northwest Italy, bordering Switzerland to the northeast and France to the northwest. For centuries, Christians were able to worship according to their conscience, but the time came when Rome insisted upon their submission. It was then that the prophecy record in Revelation 12, 13, and 14 was fulfilled. Ted Wilson saying that. Now when the dragon saw that he had been cast to the earth, he persecuted the woman who gave birth to the male child. But the woman was given two wings of a great eagle that she might fly into the wilderness to her place where she is nourished for a time and half a time from the presence of the serpent. So this Waldenese here represent the woman who went. And look, Ted Wilson, I tell you that up front. Look, Ted Wilson, I mean, making it more clear for us here. He goes on to say, in symbolic language, we understand the woman represents God's true church, who flees to the mountain where she is nourished by God's word for 1260 years during the dark ages of papal persecution. Because of papal oppression, the faithful Waldenese were forced to retreat deeper into the mountain where they could worship God according to their belief. Founded upon the written word of God, we are told the Waldenese were among the first of the peoples of Europe to obtain a translation of the Holy Scripture hundreds of years before the Reformation. They possessed the Bible in manuscript in their own native tongue. So I just given us that to help us to understand that no matter how Satan try to destroy the word of God, it was be preserved. It was be preserved. I want to skip out a few things because I'm looking at my time. Let me just close. I'll skip out a few things that what Ted Wilson said. So I just want to close it. What he said in his closing remarks. Hear what he said, you know. In the closest page, in the closing pages of this chapter, we read the inspiring words. The persecution visited for many centuries upon this God-fearing people were enduring by them with a patience and consistency that honored their Redeemer. Notwithstanding the crusade against them and the inhuman butchery to which they were subjected, they continue to send out their missionaries to scatter this precious truth. They were hunted to death, yet their blood watered the seed sown, and it failed not of yielding fruit. Scattered over many lands, they planted the seed of the Reformation. And it is to be carried forward to the close of time by those who also are willing to suffer all things for the word of God and for the testimony of Jesus Christ. So what Ted Wilson is saying here, that at time, well, not really at time, because it's upon us here already, that the same way how these worlds needs carry that word or whatever and so on, is the same thing we will have to carry it under serious persecution. And that's why Ellen White said that whatever we fail to do in the time of peace and safety, we will have to do it in some terrible, terrible time. Now we have a little peace in us. But how many of us carrying all that wood? Might be too late for some of us. I'm going to just close up here. It said the voice also ordered that the oil, remember, we look at that here. Hear what it said here. Let me just read over these verses here. It said, when he had opened the third seal, I heard the beast say, come and see. And I beheld, and lo, a black horse. And he that sat on him had a pair of balance in his hand. Remember, I explained to you this balance, what it is. It's a famine, right? For the word of God and so on. I read it for Amos. And it goes on to say, and I heard a voice in the midst of the four beasts saying, a measure of wheat for a penny, and 3 measures of barley for a penny. But the verse end up saying, and see thou hurt not the oil nor the wine. The voice also orders that the oil and the wine are not to be harmed. This suggests that the famine is not so fatal. The wine symbolizes God's gracious salvation in Jesus Christ. The oil stands for the Holy Spirit. It suggests, even though there might be a shortage of God's word in the world, and the gospel message is hidden from the people, the Holy Spirit is still at work making salvation available. The wheat and the barley signify a famine. However, in spite of a famine, survival is possible for the children of God. Remember, the Bible says that your bread and your water shall be sure. In closing here, I'll close with this verse. Isaiah 33, verse 16 said, he shall dwell on high. That's you. His place of defense shall be the mountainous rock. Bread shall be given him. His water shall be sure. That's only, folks, if you stay faithful to God. Only if you stay faithful to God. May God bless you and give you peace in your heart and peace in your home. I hope we gain a clear understanding what these 4 horses, we have 1 more horse to look at, the pale horse, right? We understand, I mean, people have all kind of different interpretation where this horse is concerned. But this really dealing where God's word and so on is concerned. All right, so may God give you peace in your heart and peace in your home. God bless you all.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Elder. And folks, we, you know, as the word tells us, we have nothing to fear indeed unless we forget the way the Lord has led us. And so it's time like these I see and realize the seriousness of the time in which we are living in, and the word of God will become a reality. For right now, there is that free opportunity whereby worship, we can have our church door open, where a person can feel free to enter in. But that famine that will come, that we are told, wouldn't be for food, nor for water. But there are those who will be crying that the church door will be open so that they can hear our word, beloved. And so God have made the necessary provision so that individual can store up or buy up the authority to know about him. So when that time shall come, because the word will be stored in our heart. And so we'll be prepared for whatever is to come. And so thank you very much, Elder, for reminding us, reminding you who are joining us online of the time in which we are living in. And just as those pioneers and what they have experienced, let us be assured, or don't be fooled, that the similar thing will also be, we also in this time will face that same scenario in proclaiming the message in a difficult time. But be for sure, the word says that the word will be proclaimed. There are those who will proclaim this message in that hard time. So let us stay faithful. Let us stay true to our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, and proclaim without any shadow of a doubt, holy dying, holy dying, that we will be their Savior, holy dying. Song number 308, I would be their Savior, holy dying.
I will be their Savior, holy thine, and teach me how, oh teach me how. I will do thy will, oh Lord, not mine, and help me now. And holy thine, holy thine, holy thine, this is my vow. And holy thine, holy thine, O Lord, just now. And what is worthly pleasure, wealth of fame, oh yes, now and with how thee, oh yes, now and with how thee, I will leave them for thy dear name, oh yes, now and this my wealth shall be. And holy thine, and holy thine, holy thine, this is my vow. And holy thine, and holy, oh holy thine, and holy thine, this just now. And as I cast a transcend joy behind, oh come down here, and come down here, oh in thy presence all in all I find, and this my comfort, yeah. And holy thine, holy, and holy thine, this is my vow. And holy, oh holy thine, holy, and holy thine, oh Lord, just now.
Let's stand to our feet as we pray. Father and eternal God, once again, we are reminded, we are being cautioned, we are called to be alert, we are called, gracious God, to be aware of the time in which we are in. And Father and gracious God, we know that there are still those that are faithful and true. And we pray, gracious God, that this message can be proclaimed boldly to those who may be in darkness. Pray that light will come. May you continue to use our elder in bringing clarity as to where your word is concerned. not his, but your will, gracious God, to be aware of the time so that we would not be caught unaware. But as we live, loving Father, the secret things, gracious God, you have said would be revealed to your people, your children, gracious God. For those that are in darkness cannot or will not be able to perceive. And so as fellow believers, as disciples of yours, we have nothing to fear. And be with us, gracious God. Continue to cover our elder, keep him, as he continues to proclaim your message boldly, gracious God. And so, your people, we pray that we can stay faithful and true. Now be with us as we are about to go to our various home. Lord, take us there in safety, as we have been energized, reinvigorated to go forth as we face the coming days that are ahead of us. And when we shall meet online on Wednesday, no, as we meet in the homes on Wednesday, gracious God, we can continue to be at your footstool, proclaiming or being able to stand in the gap on other believers and be there for one another to be strengthened through prayer, gracious God. Thank you for what you have done tonight. Thank you, gracious God. May you cover us now and keep us. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Well, a blessed good evening to one and all until Wednesday night, Wednesday evening. Just please remind those folks who ought to be in different homes on Wednesday, just call your group together. And I guess by now you'd have known where you will be going, what home you'll be going in. And I pray by God's grace that you'll have a rich experience.